If you're out in the hallways right now, I'd like to ask you to please make your way in and to find a seat. If this is your first time visiting us this morning, I'd like to say welcome to Countryside. We are very excited to have you here with us this morning. I'd also like to invite everybody who's in the overflow room. And just a reminder to our small groups that we take turns in there now to allow for extra space in here for our guests. As we prepare our hearts for worship this morning, I'd like to read for you Psalm 103, verses 1 and 2. And it says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits." Let's go ahead and stand this morning as we bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord. our Father's own here, with the power of His promise in their hearts, of a holy city built by God's own hands, a place where peace and justice reign. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our souls till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight. By faith the prophet saw a day when the longed for Messiah would appear with the power to break the chains of sin.
By faith this mountain.
By faith this mountain shall be moved, and the power of the gospel shall prevail. For we know in Christ all things are possible for all who call upon.
Thank you. You may be seated. Well, good morning. At Countryside, we take communion each week as part of our worship together. This is a time of focused remembrance centered on Jesus Christ. It's a time where we acknowledge our need and we praise God that He provided the solution to our sin problem in His Son's broken body and shed blood on the cross. Communion cups are on the tables in the back, so if you've not grabbed one yet, now's a great time to do that. And every believer in Christ is invited to take the communion elements with us this morning, whether you're a member of this church or not. If you've repented from your sins and trusted God with your whole life and placed your faith in the saving work of Christ alone, this is for you. But as you think about communion this morning, if you are confused about what you believe about Jesus, or if you are sinning against God habitually with an unwillingness to repent, or if you're under discipline at this church or another church, then you need something. And it isn't this juice and this cracker. It's what these elements point you to. You need to be forgiven and covered by the grace of God and His Son, Jesus Christ. So if that is you this morning, then take this time not to partake in these elements, but to confess your sin directly to God and ask Him to change not only your disobedient actions, but to replace your heart with all its desires and to ask Him to open your eyes to the truth of His loving grace for you. In just a moment, we're going to spend a minute or two in silence with just some music playing. And this is a time of undistracted quietness. And it's important for every single person that's gathered here this morning, because each and every one of us has failed to meet the holy standard of the righteous King of Kings. We've done things that he has said that we should not do. And we've left undone things that he has commanded of us. So we go before God now, honestly, to confess our failures to him, to ask for the forgiveness that he promises to give us, and to prepare our hearts together to remember rightly his sacrifice, with a clean conscience before God, so that we may rejoice together in what he's done for us. Let's go now to a time of prayer and reflection. If you would, go ahead and open up at least the cracker portion of your cups. And as you open it, look at the juice representing blood and the cracker representing Christ's body. And this morning, I'd like us to consider together the unbelievable affection of our God. Affection that's unbelievable, not only because we did not do anything to deserve it, but because God sacrificed so much in himself to demonstrate it. Affection so deep that we can only display shadows of its realities. Love so sacrificially complex that we can't truly comprehend what was experienced by Christ so that we could be made right with God. There's a striking moment during the crucifixion that helps us understand why the love of Jesus stands far above all other displays of love. There's not a one that compares. In chapter 23 of the Gospel of Luke, we find three men being executed publicly by crucifixion. All three were found guilty by the court. All three were seen as a threat to society. All three were sentenced to death, and yet only two of them were guilty before God. The third was there for this reason, because of his love for a world of sinners. Jesus hung there with pain surging through his body, tendons slowly ripping in his arms and legs as blood seeped into his lungs. And cutting through the air, an insult was hurled at Jesus. The insult was not from the crowd or the guards, but from one of the criminals crucified by his side. And the thief cries out in mockery, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But then something unexpected happens. The third man, the other thief, hanging on the cross, rebukes him, saying, "Do you not fear God? Since you are under the same sentence of condemnation, and we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he turns to Jesus and he says, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." What a bold request. Of all the things weighing on Jesus' mind, this criminal asked Jesus to remember him. Does he know what he's asking? Does he realize that he's requesting that Jesus, who is being crushed by God under the weight of the sins of a world of rebels, take his sin and add it to the load? Does he realize that Jesus is trying to process the betrayal from his loved ones and false accusations and the pain of a horrific scourging and brutal torture and the pangs of soon coming death under the wrath of God for sin that he did not commit? Does he realize what he's asking? I think he does. I think he does. But as he watches Jesus look with loving compassion on all those who hate him, he has come to realize that only God can love this way. Only God could go beyond the pain ravaging his body, above the insults cutting and wounding with each mocking shout, and in spite of the crushing weight of a world of sin, lovingly offer himself to save one more. Only God. So he asks, Jesus, will you love me too? Would you remember me today? And Jesus looks at him with compassion and says, truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Yes, yes, I will take yours too. As we hang here together, your body will perish, but the wrath of God for your sin will crush me and not you. Yes, I will take yours too, because my love is perfect. Friends, if you sit here today, forgiven by God and reckoned righteous, it is because Christ turned his loving gaze to you while you were a rebel, and he said, yes, I will take yours too. And if you're here this morning as one who has rejected and despised God and his gift of eternal life that he's offered to you, you need to understand that our God is not limited to express his love like a mere man would. His love is unbelievable. And even though you don't deserve it, if you place your trust in Jesus today, his response to you will look just like that of his response on the cross. Yes, I will take yours too. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Yes, I will take yours too, is the loving cry of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. And that's what we remember this morning, with his broken body and his shed blood for us. Let us remember this morning the love of Christ that takes our sin and provides righteousness, that takes our death and provides life. Our God is a God of great, unbelievable love. Amen. I would like to ask one of our deacons, Steve Vaughn, to pray for the bread.
Let us pray. Father, what a great gift. You are the bread of life. You feed all of us. It's a gift that we can never repay. As you hung on that cross, your only purpose at that point was to take our sins, take them before the Father, and become the final propitiation for all the things that we have done wrong against you. Jesus, without you, we are nothing. You are everything. We give all the glory, all the honor to you, just as the Father wished. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank you, Lord.
Let's eat together. I would like to ask another one of our deacons, Greg Allen, to pray for the juice.
Let's pray. Lord, I lift our praise and thanks to you for the perfect substitute to those who are unworthy. And we pray that we are reminded of that this morning and every day of our lives, for worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Amen.
In remembrance of him, let's drink together. Then you may stand together, please.
My Lord, King of the heavens.
Wowed by the love of God this morning. Let's pray together. Wow. God, we are amazed at your love, your affection, your compassion. As we've heard this morning and we've sung already, these great truths. Lord, please work in our hearts this morning to continue to be wowed by you as we see more of you in your word. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I'd like to invite you to turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5 this morning. We're back in our Matthew series. Matthew chapter 5. The last two sermons in Matthew have introduced and walked through the first four parts to Jesus' opening section of his famous Sermon on the Mount. And this first section of that sermon was a list that we call the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes. And what stands out clearly among the Beatitudes is a repeated conditional promise. Blessed. Blessed. We've noted that this word essentially refers to happiness. A different kind of happiness than your typical emotional booster. It's a deeper spiritual happiness, a kind of happiness that affects the entire soul. It's an enduring kind of happiness, one that leaves you satisfied, leaves you content, and it leaves you full. And our theme for the book of Matthew is we've gone through the first four chapters and into chapter five, we've consistently seen this: because Jesus is the Messiah King, we must worship and follow him. And we're going to continue that theme this morning. And hopefully you found your place in Matthew chapter 5. Please join me in standing one more time, so just make sure we get the blood going in your legs. Down, up, down, up. So as we stand together, let's, rather than reading the two verses that we have for today, which is verses 7 through 8, I love what Pastor Otto did in reading the entire list of Beatitudes in our last message. So that's what we'll do today. Let's read verses 1 through 12 in Matthew 5. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." So Lord, help us now as we look in your word to see clearly. Please work in us and help us to respond in submission to you and the working of your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I want to speak for all of our pastors just for a moment, and I think I can confidently tell you this, knowing each of those guys. But every time that we preach, every Sunday, one of us gets up here and we take the Word of God and we seek to interpret that passage that we're working through that day as a church. And that's sort of our primary focus for the week. But there's a few goals that we all share as we carry out this task. I think the first goal is obvious, that we want to rightly divide the Word of truth. That's a goal that we all share together. We want to accurately interpret the passage so that the Spirit of God can use the words of God to change the people of God to look more like the character of God. But there's another goal that we all share, and I think this might be a less obvious one. Our goal is also, by walking you through the process of interpretation, our goal is to show you how to interpret Scripture. For those of you who've been around for some time, you may have picked up on this. Every Sunday, we walk you through the process of discovering God's Word with the hope that you will learn that process and you will employ that process Monday through Saturday. So we all desire that you will be equipped in how you think about God's Word, equipped in how you look at the context of a passage, equipped to discover the Holy Spirit's intended meaning of a passage. Why? Well, so that God may use His Word in your life every day. Every day. And all that means is that our goal is not to create followers of one particular pastor or another. We don't want you walking away from here thinking, wow, that guy's a good Bible interpreter. We don't want that. Instead, we want you thinking about God and discovering God and wowed by how God communicates in His Word. And God should be the one that is in the center of our gaze. Meaning that when we leave here, God should be the one lingering on our thoughts, not the impression of a pastor, not the skill of one Bible interpreter. We're just little messenger boys that want you to know the message. And there's a reason that I wanted to point that out to you this morning. It's not false humility. It's not to make you think more of our pastors or of me. It's really to set you up for understanding why we're going to approach this passage in the way that we'll approach it this morning. And the way that we're going to approach this passage is to go through several key steps that will lead us to understanding the meaning of the text. And we'll be left with some very clear applications of the text. So if we're really honest, this text that we have before us, verses 7 and 8 of Matthew 5, seem really straightforward. It's two verses. It's only 20 words. 9 words in verse 7, 11 words in verse 8. And if we zoom out and we look at the verses, it seems rather simple. To be blessed, show mercy. You will receive God's mercy. To be blessed, be pure in heart. You'll see God. And so to take you through this process, I want you to be equipped with the right kind of questions to ask of this text, because then you'll see that there's much more profound meaning here than the simple words, be more merciful and be more pure. So we've got four questions that we're just going to start with this morning to help us evaluate the passage as we approach it. And after we've answered these four questions, I think we can really dig in. So let's start with a basic but very essential question. The question is this: how does the context affect these verses? How does the context affect these verses? And if you've heard or been here for the last two sermons in our Matthew series, you've heard Pastor Scott and Pastor Otto introduce to us the first four Beatitudes on this list in verses 3 through 6. So let's just go back to those verses, verses 3 through 6, and take in this context where we find Jesus communicating these things. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Jesus is preaching. He's on a mountain. He's preaching to his disciples. He sat down as the great teacher. So, in order to rightly interpret our text, we have to see the way that these first four Beatitudes, verses 3 through 6, we have to find out how they affect the two verses we're looking at today. And all of the legwork for our study today has actually been laid out in our last two messages. Rather than thinking of Beatitudes in verses 3 and 4, the poor in spirit and those who mourn, instead of thinking of those as monetary or emotional states of poverty, we already saw that they speak of a recognition of spiritual poverty. Spiritual poverty, a recognition of spiritual poverty. The person who recognizes that they are poor in spirit, they are broken, they are needy before a holy God, as we've already seen in our communion time this morning, that person will mourn and be broken over their condition. That person will find comfort and ultimate happiness in belonging to the kingdom of heaven. But only those who reach that low point of recognizing their spiritual poverty will ever entrust themselves to Jesus to save their souls. So recognition. Recognition. When we get to verses 5 and 6, we move from inner recognition to inner resolve. Inner resolve. Those who recognize their spiritual poverty receive the eternal blessings of the kingdom of heaven and eternal comfort, but then they move to an inner resolve toward meekness and a resolve to be satisfied in righteousness. That means they are resolved to be humble and controlled, and they're desperate for righteousness, the righteousness of God. So if the first two Beatitudes speak of recognition, and the second group speaks of resolve, then the two Beatitudes we're looking at today must continue along the same trajectory, building together in the same way that the first four are built together. And the word, I believe, sums up well the merciful and the pure in heart is the word reflection. Reflection. Because we move to action in these verses. These Beatitudes in verses 7 and 8 speak of doing and being. And so in a few moments, I hope that you'll be able to discover how each one is ultimately a reflection. Not a reflection of something, but a reflection of someone. And they will be affected by the first four Beatitudes that come before them. All right, so now we're sort of getting close in identifying the way the context affects our verses. Let's go to the next important question we need to ask. Who are the main characters in these verses? Who are the main characters in these verses? When we take our first glance, we see the verses describe a group of people, the merciful and the pure in heart. They're not necessarily named because these groups are identified in Jesus' sermon as people receiving the blessing. We can understand that these people may include us. If you're in Christ, it should, and it does. All right, so there's a group of people, but there's another character here. We need to realize that there is a character who dispenses the blessing. In verses 7 and 8, the first group of people is blessed, but who dispenses that blessing? It's God. It's God who is at the center here. God is at the center, blessing in both instances, dispensing true happiness, true, deep, satisfying happiness, the kind that fills you up and leaves you full. So we've asked the question of context. There's a progression here. We've asked the question of characters. We've identified a group of people receiving blessing and God who is dispensing the blessing. But there's a third question we need to ask, and this relates to the connection between the characters. And here's the question: are there any promises in these verses? It's a rather obvious answer. Are there any promises in these verses? We see promises in both verses 7 and 8. There's a promise of blessing, the promise of receiving mercy in verse 7. There's the promise of blessing and the promise of seeing God in verse 8. And we'll look more closely at each one in a few moments. But it's important for us to understand that there are conditional promises here. Conditional promises. And if we look again, we actually see a direct link between being blessed or happy and receiving mercy. And we see a direct link between being blessed and seeing God. And that is so important. The blessing of happiness is directly tied to receiving mercy and directly tied to seeing God. There's a fourth question we need to ask. We had to ask the other three questions first in order to ask this one. What is the condition required to receive the promises? What's the condition required to receive the promises? So to ask it another way, what's the prerequisite to receiving these promises? It's a conditional promise, so what's the condition? And it's rather plain in verse 7. The merciful. The merciful, that's the prerequisite. The people are merciful. The merciful will receive mercy and be blessed, satisfied, happy. It's also obvious in verse 8. The condition is that they are pure in heart. Pure in heart. Those who are pure in heart, Jesus says, will see God. And there's a really important theological distinction we need to make right here. This is a very important theological distinction. We could easily misunderstand this passage to mean that showing mercy, being merciful, causes God's mercy to flow to us. That's not correct. That's not what Jesus is saying. That's not the way God dispenses blessing. Our mercy does not cause God's mercy. Rather, our mercy indicates that we are positioned to receive God's mercy. Our mercy becomes the occasion in which God extends further mercy to us. That's much different than being the cause of God's mercy. If our mercy caused God's mercy to flow to us, then we would have some kind of hand in our own salvation. We would be, in one sense, responsible for God's dispensing of his mercy to us. So our mercy is not the cause of God's mercy. It's instead the occasion in which God's mercy is dispensed to us. Why? Well, because those who show mercy, God's kind of mercy, as we'll see, their condition will be unique. They are children of God. A life that reflects God's mercy is a life that's already positioned to receive God's mercy. So tying all of that together, as we get ready to jump in the passage, we can understand this. The person who recognizes their spiritual condition, and that person becomes resolved to be meek and desperate for righteousness, that person will be a reflector of God's mercy and a reflector of God's purity. That's the progression. They will be a recipient of the conditional promise, not the cause. They will receive God's mercy and will see God. So I hope that helps you really just be set up for digging deeper into the two ideas this morning, understanding the mercy and the pure heart that Jesus names here. So all of that background is necessary. We've already done just a little bit of interpretive work, just using the text this morning in a way that works together, not pulling random ideas to help us understand, but simply just using the tools that we already have right here in this passage. So for the few minutes we have left, I have a simple outline for us to go through. And it's built using the observations that we've already uncovered. So if you've been tracking this morning, I hope that this can make a lot more sense in a simple yet impactful way. Let's dig into these concepts of mercy and pure in heart. And I think it's best that we go read these two verses now together. Verses 7 and 8. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. First observation this morning is that receiving God's mercy leads to happiness. Receiving God's mercy leads to happiness. That is, our happiness comes from receiving God's mercy. The kind of happiness that we've been noting is a deep, satisfying happiness. God's mercy is at the center of this verse. Not our mercy. Not our mercy. Some people take this verse and they turn it around in a really human-centered way. Some people take this verse to mean that merciful people receive mercy from others. Be merciful and it'll come back around. Do your part. But that perspective is godless and ignores what Jesus is saying, ignores this context. Think with me just for a moment. If the blessing from Beatitude number one is the kingdom of heaven, something that comes from only God, if blessing number two is comfort, which Pastor Scott already showed us, is comfort from God, if blessing number three is inheriting the earth, a promise that is not fulfilled by other people, but is fulfilled by God, and if blessing number four in the Beatitudes is satisfaction, a satisfaction that only comes from God, that means that God is the dispenser of the blessings. And so we can rightly understand that Jesus is consistently giving us a picture of God's blessing people in each of these circumstances. So blessing number five is not mercy from people around us all of a sudden. Instead, it's the blessing of God's mercy. It's mercy from God. His mercy is center stage. It's the desired blessing here. It's the promised blessing. And so what we really need to understand is what that mercy is. What is God's mercy like? And if we understand what God's mercy is like, perhaps we can understand what the merciful person looks like. And I think the first thing to note about God's mercy is that it includes forgiveness. It includes forgiveness. It can be easy to think of God's mercy simply as forgiveness. But God's forgiveness is not exactly the same as mercy. They're very similar. God's forgiveness actually flows out of his mercy. That means that God's mercy is even bigger than his forgiveness. Well, how do we know that? How do we know that? Well, think about this. Every time God forgives, it's always merciful. It's always merciful. But God is also merciful in instances where forgiveness is not required. Take this passage, for instance. God says we will receive mercy in an instance where we're doing something good. Not an instance of sinning. While God's forgiveness is always merciful, his mercy is extended to situations where forgiveness has already been granted and the issue is not sin. God's mercy extends to instances where we're needy and weak. His compassion not only extends to our sinful condition, but to instances where we've already been forgiven, we're walking in truth, but we're in need. So we can understand that forgiveness comes out of, it flows out of God's mercy. And so that leads us to an observation about the merciful. I receive God's mercy when I forgive the guilty. I receive God's mercy when I forgive the guilty. Mercy embraces forgiveness for the guilty. And part of God's mercy is his forgiveness. That means this, that a person who is merciful the way God is merciful will be a forgiving person. They will forgive those who wrong them. How can you forgive someone? How can you be merciful the way God is merciful toward those who do you harm? And here's the answer. Jesus already laid it out. Those who are merciful like God and extend forgiveness do so because they recognize their condition before a holy God. And they are meek and they crave righteousness. And in their meekness, they will be so desperate for righteousness that they will look to God. And as they look to God, they'll agree with his word. In Lamentations, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Those who are lowly and meek will be able to forgive. Rather than being shocked and angry and vengeful, they will look to God and see God's character. And because they crave righteousness, they'll be empowered by the Holy Spirit to reflect that character. To forgive. And they will realize just how much they too have been forgiven. Paul writes in Ephesians 2, but God being rich in mercy. Because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you've been saved. God is rich in mercy. To be merciful like God includes forgiving the guilty. That's part of it. That's part of it. It's not all of it, but it's part of it. There's another aspect of God's mercy. And it's shown in times when sin is not the issue. The issue is weakness and need. And that aspect of God's mercy is his compassion. His compassion. I receive God's mercy when I have compassion toward the weak and needy. I receive God's mercy when I have compassion toward the weak and needy. See, mercy embraces compassion for the needy. We see this in the Old Testament. When God's heart was stirred because the Israelites were enslaved to the Egyptians, they were deeply oppressed. They cried out to God. God heard their cries, and he had compassion toward them. We see this in Jesus as he went through towns and villages, healing the sick and those who were oppressed by demons. He did so with compassion. And in his compassion, Jesus was moved to heal them, to bless them, to meet their needs. It was mercy shown through compassion. And God is rich in mercy. And friends, it's a reflection of God's mercy when you have compassion on the weak and needy. When you're moved with compassion to care for someone in need, and the church is the best place for you to start. It's one of the reasons why we're here. We're here to have a context to see and know and be exposed to each other's weaknesses and needs. So that when God moves in your heart to be compassionate towards someone here who is in need, you become an extension of the mercy of God in their life by meeting that need. You become God's vessel for his mercy to flow to that person, to flow to his beloved. Forgiveness and compassion are extensions of God's mercy. And God is rich in mercy. And the main reason, when we really get down to the bottom of things, the main reason why some of God's people are not merciful is because they love themselves too much. They love themselves too much to offer forgiveness. They love themselves too much to be moved with compassion, to meet the needs and help the weaknesses of others. Local church is an amazing context for you to be merciful. Because the more that you're around people here, the more opportunities you're going to have to forgive people. The more opportunities you'll have to be compassionate towards those in need. Ultimately, the local church is God's design for extending his mercy to his own people. Because he extends that mercy through his people to his people. Are you merciful? Are you merciful? God promises that those who are merciful will receive his mercy. I believe that includes the mercy of escaping God's wrath, but also includes other mercies here in this life. His mercies are new every morning. Are you wondering where God's mercy is in your life? Be merciful. Be merciful. Second, seeing God leads to happiness. Seeing God leads to happiness. So the blessing here in verse 8 is the happiness of seeing God. And the condition for that promise is a pure heart. A pure heart. By the way, there's different kinds of purity. There's different kinds of pure hearts. There's declared purity. There's declared purity. That's the purity that God declares you to have when he saved you. He purified your heart from sin. But there's also practical purity. And that's the kind of purity that requires action on your part. When you are in Christ, you cannot change your declared purity. You cannot change God's purifying work on your soul, but you can change your practical purity in how you live, in how you live. So for the sake of an outline and to tie in some application through this outline, I've got three simple ways to strive for practical purity. By the way, you might be thinking, well, this passage is about declared purity. And It could be, but if we're going to be consistent with the other Beatitudes, we see that the other Beatitudes involve personal responses and personal things happening in the individual that they're doing. They're mourning. They're poor in spirit. They're hungering and thirsting for righteousness. They're merciful. They're meek. So I believe that the pure in heart, consistently with the other Beatitudes, is talking more about the practical purity because it involves something that the person is not having automatically just happen to them. Something that they're to strive for. When Jesus says these words, the pure in heart will see God, he's not referring to seeing God face to face when you get home from here and you walk into your living room. He's not talking about something visual in the here and now. In the original language, the words Jesus used carry the idea of seeing more clearly, seeing more clearly. So what are these practical ways to see God more clearly? First of all, I see God more clearly when I submit to His Word. I see God more clearly when I submit to His Word. That's the surrendered soul. The surrendered soul. The person who wants to see God more clearly will find Him when they seek Him. And guess where the very best place to see God more clearly is? It's His Word. It's His Word. God reveals Himself through His Word, but that alone does not guarantee that you will see God more clearly. We will see God more clearly when our souls are surrendered to Him and submit to His Word. That's the positive. That's the positive. Here's the negative, and maybe this will make sense. On the negative side, when we feel far away from God, oftentimes it's because we're in sin. And every time that we sin, every time that we reject God and turn away from Him, we feel distant, like a child crying out in the darkness for their parents. Because sin clouds our vision. It clouds our view of God. And that's why some of you might feel so far away from God. You feel like you cannot see Him and that He's distant. And perhaps it's because some of you have been indulging in the flesh and refusing to repent of sin. No amount of reading is going to fix that. No amount of reading is going to fix that. You need to surrender to God. And that's why, practically speaking, we must not just be good readers of the Bible. We need to be good submitters, surrendered to God's Word so that we follow and obey what God demands of our lives. We know, and we've heard the psalmist say, "Search me, O God, and know my heart," in Psalm 139. "Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." But the most overlooked phrase from that psalm is the phrase, "Lead me in the way everlasting." You have to submit to God's way. And as you're surrendered to Him, submitting your soul to Him, God will become all the more clear to the eyes of your heart. The question we should all be asking is, what part of God will I see? What part of God will I see when I submit to His Word? What will I see more clearly? I believe the answer is that you will see His love more clearly. You'll see His heart more clearly. In a negative sense, when you're in sin and refusing to surrender, the first thing you begin doubting is God's love. You don't see His love clearly when you reject His Word. Submit to His Word. You'll begin to recognize His love extended through grace and mercies in your life. Secondly, I see God more clearly when I rely on His wisdom. I see God more clearly when I rely on His wisdom. This is the trusting soul. The trusting soul. I believe one of the crucial aspects of the pure in heart is that they trust in the Lord. They trust in the Lord. They don't trust their own judgment above God's wisdom. In a sense, they heed the words of Proverbs. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make straight your paths. He will make straight your paths. What does that mean? It means seeing more clearly. What will I see of God when I trust in the Lord? You'll see more of His wisdom. You'll see more of His perfect power orchestrating your life. You'll see more of His wisdom carried out in the twists and the turns of your life, and your confidence in Him can continue to grow. God does not promise that He will reveal what lies ahead. But Proverbs does contain the promise that He'll make our paths straight. Our paths will be walkable. We will be able to follow God's plan for us. And how will we do that? We'll do that by trusting God. And we will begin to see and understand that His wisdom is perfect. And in what He has planned for us, it is perfect. Those who are pure in heart rely on the wisdom of God. So let me ask you, are you trusting in God's wisdom? Are you trusting in God's wisdom, or are you trying to forge your own path? In a negative sense, when you ignore God's wisdom, when you turn away from following God's wisdom, you will not be able to see Him clearly. You'll be blinded by your own foolishness. And then third, I see God more clearly when I walk by the Spirit. I will see God more clearly when I walk by the Spirit. This is the undivided soul. The undivided soul. Those who are pure in heart, practically, will be undivided in their devotion to God. And we know this is a huge battle. This is a huge battle. There's a battle between your flesh and the Spirit of God. Paul talks about it in Romans 7. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being, but I see in my members another law, waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. The challenge for us, the challenge for us is to be undivided in our devotion to God, casting aside the nagging desires of our sinful flesh. Your flesh is real and it still calls out to the depths of your heart, demanding your allegiance, demanding your attention. Are you divided in your devotion to God? Or are you undivided as you reject the desires of the flesh to follow Him? Paul tells us how to be undivided. He says it in Galatians. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. Walk by the Spirit. Obey the Spirit of God. Keep in step with the Spirit as God convicts your heart. Respond with yes. As God moves you with compassion to show mercy, say yes. When God burdens your soul with the opportunity to share Christ, say yes. When God leads you through His Spirit to reflect the character of Jesus Christ, say yes to God. As I walk by the Spirit, when my life is undivided devotion to God, what will I see of God? What will I see of God? You will see His character. You will see His character because His character will begin to characterize you. In fact, Galatians lists the product of the Holy Spirit working in our lives. If you go read that list, it doesn't look anything like our world. It doesn't look like anyone other than Jesus. Are you walking by the Spirit? Are you undivided in your devotion to God? And when we take this whole verse in Matthew 5 into account, we can understand that to be declared pure at the moment of salvation guarantees we'll see God face to face one day. But right here on this earth, being pure in heart practically means submitting to God's word, relying on God's wisdom, and following His Spirit. It's a soul that is a surrendered soul, a trusting soul, an undivided soul. That person will see God more clearly. They will see His love more clearly. They will see His wisdom more clearly. They'll see His character more clearly. Are you seeing God more clearly? Are you seeing God more clearly than you did this time last year? Are you a person that's pursuing practical purity of heart? I want to close this morning by taking our interpretive study and just zooming back out for a second. We started with a zoomed out lens, and then we zoomed in closely on the text, and we're zooming back out once more. When we look at the progression that Jesus is giving in these Beatitudes, we see the first two as a recognition. We see the second two as a resolution. And we see the two Beatitudes from today as a reflection. Recognition, resolution, reflection. Do you see the effects of this reflection? Do you see it? I want you to get this. Those who are around us, when we reflect God's mercy and we reflect God's character through purity of heart, what happens? Those around us receive mercy. Because they receive the kind of mercy we've received from God. What's the result of the pure in heart? Well, they reflect God. And guess what? Those around us see God more clearly. These two great beatitudes of reflection serve a great purpose. When we reflect God to those around us, others experience His kind of mercy. And they see Him more clearly reflected in us. While we experience the blessing of God's mercy and we experience the blessing of seeing God more clearly, so do those around us. And all of that is so that people might get a glimpse of God from the reflection. And by getting that glimpse, they might be drawn closer to the source, the person whom we're reflecting, so that they might recognize their condition, becoming poor in spirit and mourning over their sin, so that they will become resolute, meek in spirit, and desperate for righteousness, so that they might do what? So they too might reflect the mercy of God and the heart of God to people that your reflection could never reach. Did you know that your choices to be forgiving, a forgiving person and a compassionate person, really a merciful person, did you know that your choices could have such an effect, could be used by God in such a way? Did you know that your surrender to God and your trust in His wisdom and your undivided devotion to God could be used by God to reflect Himself to someone else? So here's the question today, and we'll close with this. Are you reflecting the Messiah King? Or are you reflecting an image of someone else? Let's pray. Lord, thank You for the time we've had in Your Word this morning. Ultimately, Lord, we know that You are the one to be praised for any good work in us. You're to be praised for extending mercy to us. You're to be praised for declaring those of us who are in Christ declared pure, purified from
the guilt of sin and from the control of sin, free from it, with clean hearts. But Lord, you're also to be praised for the mercies that you extend to us in our everyday lives. Sometimes we recognize those mercies and sometimes we don't. But Lord, you're to be praised for them. You're always merciful to us. You're always merciful. Lord, you're also to be praised for any good work that happens in our hearts when we surrender. It's because you've empowered us to surrender. You've enabled us to surrender. When we trust you, it's because you've helped us to trust you. You've empowered us to trust you. When we have an undivided soul, it's because you've enabled it. So God, you're to be praised through and through. Help us to be people who praise you for all of the good things that you do in us and the things that we're to be striving for. Help us to look to you as the one who can accomplish those things in us. So Lord, help us to be moved by your word today. In Jesus' strong name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's all stand together.
Gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold. My hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Shepherd with